Children, how are you all? I hope you all are doing well. So today we will start with the history's first chapter, the Sultans of Delhi. Before we proceed with the chapter, let me inform you that Delhi was centrally located on the bank of River Yamuna and it had been the capital city for many years for many kingdoms. Now, Mohammad Ghori, a Ghurid ruler, had defeated the forces of Prithviraj Chauhan. Prithviraj Chauhan was the last ruler of the Chauhan dynasty in 1192 in the Battle of Tehran. And finally, Mohammad Ghori established his kingdom in the capital city of Delhi. Now we will look at the timeline, which will show you the five dynasties during the period of Delhi Sultanate. And the first slave dynasty started in 1206. And the final Delhi Sultanate period got over of all the rulers of all the five dynasties in 1526. So let's have a quick look at it. Children, first of all, we'll go through this timeline. There were five dynasties which started the Delhi Sultanate. This was the period from 1206 to 1526 century. And this was the time period of the Delhi Sultanate. During this period, there were five different dynasties that ruled the Delhi region. And these were the slave dynasty. They started their rule from 1206 and got ended in 1290. After the slave dynasty, they came the Khalji dynasty. It started from 1290 to 1320. After the Khalji dynasty, the Tughlaq dynasty established their rule from 1320 to 1414. And the Sayyid dynasty, after the Tughlaq dynasty, that was from 1414 to 1451. And the last dynasty of the Delhi Sultanate was the Lodhi dynasty, which established their rule from 1451 and got declined in 1526. Children, as we have gone through the timeline of the period of the Delhi Sultanate existence, and also the names of the five dynasties that existed in the Delhi Sultanate period. Now let us look at the sources. So this sources means someone or something that supplies us information. So before we go on to the history of the Delhi Sultanate, let us see that there were various information that we have got to know about the account. So account here means the report of what happened in this period. The first information was given through the coins. The second was architecture of buildings. So the architecture here means the art of designing and construction of buildings. Now the third was through the mosques. The fourth was through the accounts of foreign travelers. So this account means the report made by the foreign travelers after looking into the events and those of the court chroniclers. So this court chroniclers means the historical event that took place in the court of the Delhi Sultanate. So this gives us a lot of information about how the state was being developed and the activities of the people of those times. Now the second information that we have got through is the famous traveler. His name was Ibn Battuta. He had come from Morocco. And his Travelgus. Travelgus is a book that is written by the experience of traveling. And it provides us a valuable information, important information. Valuable means important information about the reign of Muhammad Tughlaq. So this book of Ibn Battuta, this provides an important information about the reign is the rule of Muhammad Tughlaq. Now, another information which we have got through is through Hasan Nizami. So, Hasan Nizami, he was a person who moved from one place to another in a country. So, now he was a migrant. Migrant means a person who moves from one place to another within a country. Now, he had come from Ghazni and he had provided us information about Qutbuddin Aibak. Another information which we have got through is the literature works of Minhaj-e-Siraj. So Minhaj-e-Siraj was the 13th century Persian historian born in Firozpur, new modern day of Afghanistan. Now he was the one who has written a book called Tabaqat-e-Nasiri. It's a literary work in a book that tells us about the Delhi Sultans. Another information is given through Ziauddin Barani. So Ziauddin Barani, he was a Persian Muslim historian. So now he lived in the court of Muhammad Tughlaq and Firoz Tughlaq, and he has written an account. Account is the report, which is known as Tariq-e-Firoz Shahi, and this also gives us a report of political history of the Delhi Sultanate. So Ziauddin Barani has mentioned in his book regarding the political situation of the India, how the administration was run, or what were the system and the policies introduced in the period of Delhi Sultanate. So these all things have been mentioned in the political history of the Delhi Sultanate. However, if someone is dealing with this interpreting, so interpreting means the way it has been explained. So now if someone is dealing with the way it has been explained, we have to be careful about these reports, because the chroniclers, the same word here, the chronicler means the historical events, they happened in the courts of the rulers and the international travelers who had seen the only part of the region. Now they have given the information, their writings are not very holistic. Holistic means it means that they are not in detail, or it has just been a part of it, and whatever the information that they have written it down on their account or the reports, that is not very holistic. So holistic means it is not so in detail and may even vary from the ground reality. So ground realities is the actual reality that it may vary from. Now let us move on to the slave dynasty. So children, as I have talked to you all about the names of the five dynasties, the period of the Delhi Sultanate, and the information through which we get to know about the period of Delhi Sultanate, now let's talk about the first dynasty of the Delhi Sultanate, which is the slave dynasty. This dynasty started from 1206 and got over in 1290. Now these are the rulers of the slave dynasty, that is Qutbuddin Aibak. He was the slave or servant of Muhammad Ghori. Iltutmish, he was the son-in-law of Qutbuddin Aibak. Razia Sultan, the third ruler of the slave dynasty, and she was the only first and the last Muslim women ruler to take the throne of Delhi. The last ruler of the slave dynasty, known as Ghiyasuddin Balban. Now we will move on to the first ruler of the slave dynasty, who was Qutbuddin Aibak. So Qutbuddin Aibak, he was the founder, meaning he established the slave dynasty. He was the first person to find the slave dynasty or to establish the slave dynasty. And he was a slave of Muhammad Ghori. So he was a servant, slave meaning servant of Muhammad Ghori. And Qutbuddin Aibak had helped Muhammad Ghori in winning the second battle of Tehran in 1192 century. So this battle of Tehran, which is the second battle of Tehran, that was fought between the forces of Prithviraj Chauhan, the last ruler of the Chauhan dynasty, and Muhammad Ghori, the Ghorid ruler. And Qutbuddin Aibak had helped Muhammad Ghori to win this battle of Tehran in 1192. After that, Muhammad Ghori established his kingdom in Delhi. Now, Qutbuddin Aibak, he was given the responsibility to look after the territory, meaning state or province of Muhammad Ghori. And after the death of Muhammad Ghori, Qutbuddin Aibak, he declared himself as the Sultan in 1206 century. Now, Qutbuddin Aibak, he started to rule from Delhi. And he was a great commander, meaning he was a person with authority. And He tried to strengthen his position. Strengthen means to make his position stronger. So strengthen means stronger. He's made his position stronger with the help of marriage alliances. So marriage alliances means he got into the relationship of marriage. And Aibak was also famous for his generosity. So generosity means he was a kind person and he was famous as a kind person. And he was called Lakhbaksh. Lakhbaksh means the giver of lakhs. He was a patron of art. Patron means he had keen interest in the field of arts and he supported arts. And he constructed Qutub Minar, which started during the rule of Qutbuddin Aibak, and it got later completed under the rule of Iltutmish. Qutbuddin also built a mosque known as Quwwat-ul-Islam. And Qutbuddin could not follow his policy of expansion. So this policy of expansion means he could not take over large number of territories or state or provinces, because he just ruled for 4 years and he died while he was riding a horse. And he died in the year 1210 century. So now after Qutbuddin Aibak, we will talk about Iltutmish. So Iltutmish, he was the son-in-law of Qutbuddin Aibak. And now let us move on to the second ruler of the slave dynasty, who was Iltutmish, and he was the son-in-law of Qutbuddin Aibak. He faced many difficulties, means he faced many problems during his reign. Reign means during the time of his rule. Now to keep a check on the powers of the nobles, he organized a team of 40 loyal slaves who kept him informing about the happenings in the kingdom. So their job was to inform the sultans about what is going to happen within the empire and what was happening in the kingdom. So he was also able to check the Mongol invasion. This word invasion means attack. And he used to check this from the Northwest Frontier. So Northwest Frontier is a province which was a part of British India and now it is a part of Pakistan, and it was established in 1901. So he checked all this Mongol attack from the Northwest Frontier through his diplomatic skills. So here diplomatic means a person acting in a way that do not cause harm to someone. And he had very cleverly skills. Now, he also followed an aggressive policy towards Rajputs. So aggressive is he was harsh towards Rajputs. Now, finally, what Iltutmish did was he divided his empire into Iktas. So Iktas were the provinces. And these were given to the nobles, and these nobles had to maintain law and order and collect revenues. Revenue means the tax from the Iktas, the provinces. Now these nobles, who was the head of the Iktas, they were known as Iktidars or Muktis. And let us talk about the coins introduced by Iltutmish. The two coins that was introduced by Iltutmish was silver tanka and copper jitals. So silver tanka, it had the inscription in Sanskrit and that had the picture of a bull or Shivalinga. And let us talk about copper jitals. So copper jitals, these were the coins used for daily purpose in Afghanistan and Northwest India. So these two, silver and copper jitals and silver tanka, they were the coins that was issued from Delhi. And along with that, he was a skillful administrator. So administrator is a person who is in charge of creating and enforcing rules and regulations. And he was organizer. So organizer, whatever events used to happen or whatever things were there to be arranged in the empire, that was to be arranged by Iltutmish. And a diplomat. So diplomat, as I already told you, that he was a person that he acted to someone that did not cause any harm to someone. Now we have done with Iltutmish empire and his rule, and let us talk about Razia Sultan now. Now let us talk about Razia Sultan. She was the first and the last Muslim women ruler to take the throne of Delhi after the death of Iltutmish in 1236. First of all, his son Ruskinuddin took over the throne, but he was unable to manage properly and he was incompetent. The word incompetent means he did not have the skills of a successful ruler and he was poor in administration. So whatever rules and regulation was put up in the system, he was unable to manage those rules and regulation. So that's why Razia overthrew him, and she had all the qualities of a great leader or a ruler. Now the nobles did not want her to accept as a ruler, because nobles thought that if she becomes a ruler, then they have to be subservient, meaning they have to listen to her orders and obey them to a woman. And therefore the nobles of Multan, Lahore and Badaun, they revolted, means they agitated against Razia Sultan. They accused her of giving preference to Malik Yakut, whom she raised to a high position of administrative power. Now they said that Razia Sultan, she was blamed, means accused, and they revolted, means they agitated the nobles of Multan, Lahore and Badaun. They revolted or they agitated against Razia Sultan because they blamed Razia Sultan that she was giving preference to Malik Yakut. So Malik Yakut, he was actually the slave and puppet of Razia's stepmother. Later Razia had given him the authority of the administrative power. So he had all the qualities as a commander or a leader. He was able to manage all the rules and regulation properly. That's why Razia placed him in the field of administration. So now serious rebellion was instigated. Rebellion means there was a serious conflict or fight that was instigated or initiated, meaning by Altunia, the governor of Bhatinda. So the governor of Bhatinda, Altunia, he raised a serious conflict that was initiated, that was between Razia and Altunia. Now Razia, she marched towards Bhatinda, taking along with her trusted Malik Yakut, because she wanted to quell the rebellion. Quell means she wanted to suppress the rebellion, means the fight, the revolt or the conflict. So that's why she moved with Malik Yakut and the other forces, but they were waylaid. Waylaid is they were stopped, and Yakut was killed and she was put into jail, which is imprisoned. Now the throne of Delhi was taken over by her brother Behram. Now looking at all this, Razia, she thought that she could not move out of the imprisonment of Altunia, and she finally married Altunia, and they both went to overthrow Behram from the throne of Delhi, but they both failed and they got killed, and she died in the year 1240. So now Razia, she was known to be the icon. Icon means she was known to be the symbol of strength, and she had taken the challenge in that orthodox social systems. So orthodox social systems, though in those times, considering a Muslim woman on the throne was not as good as placing a man on the throne, because in those times, people used to think that if they place the women on the throne, then they would be superior towards men. That's why she had challenged that situation in those orthodox social systems. So orthodox means that those who follow all the rules and regulation regarding the caste, regarding the creed at that time. So in those times she had challenged all those situation and she stood on the throne of Delhi. She dressed and she acted in a manner. Her behavior was like whenever she went with her dress on, then she showed that she had courage. Displayed means showed courage and a valor. Valor means she could face the danger. Now she was a good administrator. Now she could manage all the things, the rules and regulation properly in a system. So after the death of Razia Sultan, there were many weak rulers who came to the throne of Delhi till 1266 century. Now we know about Razia Sultan, and we move on to Ghiyasuddin Balban, the last ruler of the slave dynasty. Then let us move on to Ghiyasuddin Balban. He was one of the great rulers of the slave dynasty. He followed the policy of blood and iron. So following the policy of blood and iron means he never spared his enemies. Use of sword was there during the time of fight and shredded blood out of their body. Now, to make his position strong in the society, he took some following measures. Measures means he took some following steps. First is he managed to keep some efficient spies. Efficient means active, spy means some kind of secret agencies. Now, what these secret agencies used to do was hidingly, they used to watch the activities of the nobles, governors and other officials to inform the sultans Ghiyasuddin Balban. And another thing what he did was he put forward the policy of divine rights of the kings. So he said that now he has the rights directly from the god to rule and he is not from the people. And he also said that according to which Sultan is the representative of God on the earth. So he represents whom? He represents God. He told people about it. Now he made a practice of sijda. So now sijda, this is a practice of kneeling down and touch the ground with your forehead, and this will show respect to the king. This was applied to all the people of the kingdom. Whenever they used to meet the king, then they had to kneel down and touch the forehead on the ground, and this used to show respect to the king, like similarly we do it for the gods. Now, another thing what he did was he maintained strict discipline in the court and he maintained distance from the courtier. So courtier means the advisors, and he also maintained distance from the nobles. He himself, so he also was in charge of the entire administration. He used to make rules and regulation. He used to look after that. He used to apply the rules and regulation. Everything was done in the administration by Ghiyasuddin Balban. And he made appointments according, he chose people according to his will. Now, he crushed the revolts by Mewati Rajput. So, he crushed means he suppressed the revolts by whom? Mewati Rajputs, created by Mewati Rajputs. So this Mewati Rajputs, they are the Muslim Rajput community from northwest India, particularly in and around Mewat district of Haryana and parts of Alwar. So now he suppressed the revolts by Mewati Rajput and rebellions in the Dab. So rebellions are the enemies were in the Dab area. So this Dab means an area which is the land lying between the tributaries of two rivers. Now, this created a reign of terror. Means a reign of terror. Terror means extreme fear. So his rule at that time, it created an extreme fear over the people. Now we move on to see that he wanted to protect the kingdom from the attack of the Mongols. So now he saw that frequently they were being attacked by the Mongols, his kingdoms were being attacked by the Mongols. So now he wanted to protect the kingdom. For that reason, he constructed, means he built strong forts. So forts are the buildings, huge buildings and strong buildings. These are meaning forts in the frontier. So frontier means the border area, and kept the forces. So he kept his forces there. And personally, he was also a self-disciplined person. He maintained self-discipline and he had given up drinking. Quit means given up drinking and indulging in excess. So indulging in excess means that he never used to do things which was not allowed to be done in the society. Now, he never appeared casual in public life. So, he was a very formal person in the public. He dressed formally, and when he was outside the quarters, he dressed formally. So, now we come to the end of Ghiyasuddin Balban's rule. Now, we move on to the next dynasty, that is the Khalji dynasty. have finished the first dynasty in the Delhi Sultanate, that is the slave dynasty. Now we come to the second dynasty, which is the Khalji dynasty, and its rule began from 1290 to 1320. There were two rulers of the Khalji dynasty, who were Jalaluddin Firoz Khalji and his nephew Aladdin Khalji. So now the slave dynasty, it got collapsed, means it got over within 4 years of time after the death of Balban in 1287. Now the other powers, the other sultans, they commenced amongst the others who had ambition to take over the throne. Now these sultans had started, proceeded, or they began to fight amongst themselves to take over the throne in Delhi. So now Jalaluddin at this time, he was a commander of the army. He means he was the in charge. The commander means the in charge of the army, and he was the grandson of Balban, and he took advantage of the situation and became the founder of Khalji dynasty. So he laid the foundation, means he established Khalji dynasty and he declared himself as one of the rulers of Delhi. But unfortunately means unluckily, he himself was at that time, he was 70 years of age when he captured Delhi, and soon after that his nephew Aladdin Khalji murdered him. So this was the end of Jalaluddin Khalji. Now we come to the second ruler of the Khalji dynasty, that is Aladdin Khalji. Come to the second ruler of the Khalji dynasty, that was Aladdin Khalji, and he was a great military commander. So he was in army and he was in charge of the army, that is commander and administrator. So it means administrator means a person who is in charge of creating and enforcing rules and regulations. So he was in charge of the army and he was in charge of the administrative system. Now his ambition was to be a conqueror like Alexander. He wanted to win this world like Alexander, conquer. So he wanted to win like Alexander, and according to him, the revolts that were taking place were because nobles were leading luxurious life. So now he thought that revolts means the fights that were happening because the nobles were leading a luxurious life. So luxurious life means they were leading a comfort life, and they were hatching conspiracies. So hatching means they were making some conspiracies, means secret plans. Now he also observed another thing, that whatever the network of spies, the secret agencies who used to keep a watch on the nobles and governors, they were weak. Now to check all these activities happening in the kingdom, he took some following measures, means steps. He first of all organized a successful system of spies to keep a watch on nobles and governors. So he appointed certain group of people, those who were responsible to watch the activities hidingly of the nobles and the governors, and later they had to inform it to the Sultan. Second thing what he did was, he restricted the sale of wine and restricted social gatherings of nobles. So now he prohibited, means restricted, the sale of the wine was banned, and restricted social gatherings of nobles. So he did not happen that the nobles should be making a social gathering. Now another thing what he did was, he confiscated, he took away all the properties of the nobles which they had received as gifts or grants. Now these are all the policies in the administrative field of Aladdin Khalji. Now he brought another policy, which was the economic policy, to improve the economic condition in the kingdom. Now he wanted to provide some essential, means necessary commodities, means goods, to people at reasonable, at cheap price. And at the same time, he wanted to collect money for maintaining his large army. So again, he took some following measures, meaning steps, to take care of this as well. First thing what he did was, he started regulating to fix, or he lowered the price of the goods at some cost, meaning of the essential items. So he fixed or he lowered the prices of some essential or important items. And another thing what he did was he controlled the sale of the items so that everyone could get them. So he controlled the sale of the items so that everyone could get them. And the third thing what he did was he appointed some special officers or inspectors who could make sure, ensure is to make sure that traders, that businessmen, okay, traders meaning businessmen, they sell the good at the fixed price and they do not hoard. Hoard meaning they do not hide the selling products. Now, we will see that he sent spies to keep a check on any irregularities. Now, what he did was, he also sent his spies, the secret agencies, to keep a check on whether any irregularities are happening in the society or not. Means anything which is against the rule are happening within the society or not. He used to send his secret agencies to keep a watch on that. Now the other thing what he did good for the economic condition improvement was keeping a check on weights and measures. Now this weight and measures means uniform process to verify weights, volume, length or count, ensuring that the consumer or people get the quantity that they pay for and that businessmen selling the quality or the quantity that they pay for and that business sell the quantity that they advertise. Now, he also kept a check on all those things. Now, another thing was he established a system of godowns. So, these godowns are the houses where the stocks are kept. For example, like the crops or grains or you can say the other eatable items that are to be stocked inside this godown. Now, this place was to be stored with grains after crops and release the same when required. So, when the crops got harvested and then they used to keep all those goods in the godown and whenever the requirement was there, then it used to be released from there. The last thing what he applied to improve the economic condition was he punished the person who does wrong in the society, means he punished the offenders. This was the policy of Alauddin Khalji. These are all the administrative and the economic policies that was introduced by Alauddin Khalji. Now let's look at the revenue policy of Alauddin Khalji. Now we have gone through the administrative policies and the economic policies of Alauddin Khalji. Now let us start with the revenue policy, meaning tax policy of Alauddin Khalji. Alauddin Khalji, to make sure that he maintained enough stock of food and had enough money for his army, he raised the tax level to 50% of the produce of the peasants. Peasants meaning farmers. So Alauddin Khalji, he wanted that people should have enough food and at the same time he also should have enough money to manage his army. So whatever the crops were being produced by the farmers, there was a charge of 50% tax on the crops produced, meaning yield. Now, all the lands were declared as state land. He confiscated. Confiscated means he seized or he took over all the properties that was being given to different sections of people by the previous rulers. Now, Alauddin's administrators. Administrators are the people who are in charge of enforcing laws, rules and regulations. So now these administrators, they were responsible for carrying out some certain duties in the organization, and these administrators of sultans, they used to measure the land holding. So land holding means a piece of land, they used to measure it and then they used to maintain a record, meaning accounts of all those lands. And some of the landlords, and these landlords meaning the owner of the land, they also served as the tax collector. The old landlords were responsible for collecting tax, meaning revenue from the land or other taxes from the other things. Now we have covered the revenue policies. Now let us come to the security of the Northwest frontier. And now we have gone through the revenue policies, the administration policies, and the economic policies of Alauddin Khalji. Now let us move in to the security of the Northwest frontiers. Before we move into the security of the Northwest frontiers, now let us talk more about Malik Kafur. So Malik Kafur, his original name is said to be Chandram, and he was also called Hazar Dinari or Thousand Dinar Kafur. Why he was so called? Because this was the amount that was paid by Sultan for his profession, meaning job. He was a slave, meaning servant, who became a general in the army of Alauddin Khalji. Now Malik Kafur, he had become a general, meaning a commander or an in charge in the army of Alauddin Khalji. Alauddin Khalji, he was the ruler of the Delhi Sultanate from 1296 to 1316 century. Now Kafur rose quickly in the army. His position grew fast in the army. Between 1309 and 1311, Malik Kafur, he led two campaigns in South India. Campaigns meaning military operations in South India. The first was against Warangal and the other was against Madurai. After winning these two operations, he was made the senior commander or the senior in charge of the army. And after his southern campaigns, he took the forces of Sultan against the capital of the Yadava kingdom and Devagiri. Now he further led invasions southward. Invasion means he went southwards to conquer. And he conquered the places of Kakatiya dynasty, and he won immense, means a very large place, wealth, any kind of things in a large number. Now he won immense riches for the Sultanate. So he won wealth, or you can say territories, meaning riches, in large numbers, and he won it for the Sultans. So according to the Muslim historian Ziauddin Barani, Kafur, when he came back to Delhi, he had 241 tons of gold, 20,000 horses, and 612 elephants. So these elephants were laden. Laden means these elephants had carried the looted treasure. Now looted treasure means the treasure or the things that had been stolen. Treasure is the thing and looted means stolen. So when he came back to Delhi, he had come with all those things. This was 241 tons of gold, 20,000 horses, and 612 elephants. These elephants were carrying the stolen treasure. Now we have talked about Malik Kafur. Now we will move on to the last part of the video, that is the security of the Northwest frontiers. And now we come to the last part of the video, that is the security of the Northwest frontiers. Security means protection, and how Alauddin protected his kingdom from the Northwest frontier side. Now Alauddin Khalji, he wanted to secure his kingdom, and he got the repair of the old forts done. Now this forts meaning the old buildings, huge buildings on the Northwest frontiers, and appointed special governors. So these governors were the officials, and strong armies were stationed in Multan. These strong armies were placed or kept in Multan, and they were responsible of defending, meaning protecting the borders, and these were given to the experienced generals like Zafar Khan and Malik Kafur. So now this responsibility of protecting the border was given to the experienced generals or the commander in charge of the army like Zafar Khan and Malik Kafur. Aladdin, he succeeded in establishing a vast empire. Now Aladdin, he took over the vast empire and he was a successful ruler in taking the vast empire in India. So in the northwestern region, it extended up to the river Indus. In the east, it extended in the areas of Uttar Pradesh, Orissa, Bihar and parts of Bengal. In the north, the empire extending from Punjab to the Vindhyas. In the south, except the Pandyas rulers, all others accepted his suzerainty. So this suzerainty meaning his overlordship or his superiority. Now in the south, all the rulers except the Pandya rulers, they did not accept his overlordship meaning. Now let us also look at the map, which these all areas are the areas that has been captured or won by Aladdin Khalji. This were the Bihar, Orissa, then we see a part of Bengal, we see part of this Multan, Lahore. So these all are the areas of conquered by Aladdin Khalji. Now we come to the end of this video. Children, now in our next video, we will talk about the remaining dynasties, that is the Tughlaq dynasty, invasion of Taimur, Sayyid dynasty, the Lodi dynasty, and what were the causes of the collapse of the or the decline of the Sultanate. Thank you.